have realized a few things. For instance, I want to make the, and I'm always keeping in mind what my listeners can use, which makes my job easy. So I have a very clear mission for my podcast. And rather than try to compete with other formats, there are a few resources that people could take a look at. The Blue Ocean Strategy, 1,000 True Fans, which is an essay. So the Blue Ocean Strategy is a book. 1,000 True Fans is an essay by Kevin Kelly. But the general point being, I wanted to create a new category. I didn't want to compete in a pre-existing category. So the actionable description of my podcast is a primary differentiator. And that,
so explain.
What I mean by that is, if I ask someone, what have you learned? There are a few issues with that. And let me back into this, though, because I think the point will be better made in the following way. If my charter is to find actionable information, in other words, I wake up early, if their answer to what do you do in the morning is I wake up early, I have breakfast, I have coffee, and then I meditate, is that actionable? Is there sufficient detail in that answer for someone to replicate their recipe? No, there isn't.
Not at that level of detail.
No, what time do you wake up? What breakfast? What type of milk? If they say milk. What type of coffee? How do you prepare your coffee? Why did you choose that coffee? I really dig into the specifics so that if it were a step-by-step recipe, someone could replicate the outcome or at least take a stab at it. And therefore, I can approach that a few different ways. The first is to do what most people do, fairly enough, which is how do you start your morning? And then ask a lot of follow-up questions.
It feels like there's the what question is what coffee, and then naturally the why question follows. Why this coffee?
That's one approach. So another approach would be, can you please describe the first 90 minutes of your day being as specific as possible? For instance, if you wake up early, what time do you wake up? If you drink coffee, what kind of coffee do you drink? Then I save myself 5 minutes of follow-up questions on each point, which is very interruptive, and they might lose track of what they did first, second, third, fourth, fifth. Yeah. Similarly, I'm keeping in mind with the questions that I ask, if I try to take the responsibility entirely for the interview. In other words, if it's a bad interview, it is my fault. I take full blame. In the same way that I blame teachers for bad student outcomes. I don't blame students typically. I think the problem is very often on the teacher side. And for that reason, I would look at a question like, what are your favorite books? Sounds like, or what are your two or three favorite books? It seems like a very good question. What I learned over time, because I asked this question, is it's not. Why is it not a good question? Most of the people I'm interviewing have read hundreds or thousands of books. And they will, if surprised by that question, which they would be, they will choose, there will be a primacy or recency effect. They'll choose something that first pops to mind. But if they had 30 minutes to think about it, they probably give entirely different answers. That's problem number one. The search query is too wide, if that makes sense. The second issue is that, and this is particularly true as people, as the interview subjects themselves are better and better known, is as they give answers, they've been burned by media before by having things taken out of context or being quoted. They would worry that their favorite book, in quotation marks, would then be sort of etched in stone in Wikipedia or somewhere else with an answer, so they'll defer. They'll say, ah, it's so hard, there's so many good books. And it ends up being a wrestling match. So asking instead, what books have you gifted the most to other people, gets a safe answer and also a more widely applicable answer.
It's concrete, too.
It's super concrete. So I tend to ask very, very specific questions when possible. That is not always true with follow-up questions. So there are a few cheat follow-up questions. And by cheat, I mean they very reliably get good additional information. One is, what did you learn from that? And the other one is, how did you feel when that happened, when you did that? And so what did you learn and how did that feel are two follow-up questions that you can tag onto almost anything. Or can you give me an example? That's another one that I use a lot more than most interviewers. And I don't let them wriggle out of it generally.